Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My apologies again for not complying to time. Just going to deal with one topic tonight, so inshallah ta'ala we might not even need 2 hours. So, but what we're going to give, inshallah ta'ala, is no matter how little or how much, what this lesson is all about practice and putting to practice to modify our character to the character of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is why we call the course the greatest example. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي اللهم لا سهل إلا ما جعلته سهلا وأنت تجعل الحزن إذا شئت سهلا سهلا الحمد لله رب العالمين يقول المؤلف رحمه الله ونفعنا به وبكم. The author, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy be with him and with us, and may you benefit through him and through you. He says, training the nafs to be generous and different by expending one's possessions and money liberally and without hesitation. This is going to be the topic for tonight. Spending one's possessions and spending one's nafs, one's time, one's ability, spending one's entire being, one's dad, for the sake of Allah, for the sake of others, this is without a doubt the mark of true da'wah. When a person give you time, your ilm, your manners, your money, everything that you possess for other people so that they may attain good in the dunya and in the year after. If it's not to attain good, it is not spending of yourself. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, لَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ. You will never attain birr. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not address birr as a specific type of birr. Birr is a general term for all good character. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not confine it to a specific good character, whether it's good speaking, whether it's good conduct, whether it's whatever it may be. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala left it open-ended. And how to attain it? لَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ. Until you spend everything that you love, your sleep, your time, your money, your energy, all of these things are very dear to us. Don't have much time on my hands now. I'm busy with this particular assignment. I'm busy with this particular work now. I'm putting up the cupboards. Don't disturb me. Don't interrupt me. I'm cleaning. I'm cooking. I'm this, you know. At that point when we are so engaged with what we are doing and we sacrifice and we cut off for others, something amazing happens. And this is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens the doors of tawfiq and the doors of rahmah and the most extraordinary karamat. If one wants to see a karamat, if one do that, a karama will indeed happen. Indeed happen. And one of the greatest things that man is, the greater the attachment is to this particular thing that one wants to sort of protect or want to keep to oneself, the greater this is to you, the greater the karama, or the greater the gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The greater the gift, no. Yeah, this ayah was revealed with the sabab nuzul, or not the sabab nuzul for this ayah, but one of the sahabas, Ridwanullah alayhim, Sayyidina Abu Talha, Sayyidina Talha ibn Ubaydillah, when he heard this ayah, he said, Ya Rasulullah, the most beloved thing to me immediately, his immediate response when this ayah was read to him, he said, Oh Rasulullah, I've got something that's really, really, it's my prized possession. What is it, Ya Talha? And he said, well, it's this biruha, it's a garden, And in the center of the garden is this well and this spring. And it feeds all the vegetation around it. And it's beautiful and it's green in the center of Medina. I want to give it to you. And it's the most beloved position to me. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, as Talha ibn Ubaidillah became one of the greatest known Sahaba. His name has been mentioned in several instances of chivalry and of benevolence and of selflessness. Radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So this particular act of giving oneself is, in a nutshell, called futuwa. Chivalry, futuwa. And if you want to look at definitions of futuwa, there's many definitions of futuwa. There's a definition that's a jahili definition, and there is a after jahili definition, a pre-Islamic, in other words, and an Islamic definition. The pre-Islamic definition, if you look at the poets in pre-Islam, in Jahiliya, when they describe futuwa, they describe it sometimes as somebody that's indulging in all sorts of ma'asi, all sorts of sin, drinking, you know, insulting with eloquency another tribe, somebody that's not afraid to, you know, to treat women illicitly, and all of these things. This is futuwa. And then there's another definition, all from very famous poets, that they describe futuwa as somebody who has saja'a, bravery. And there's other people who describe futuwa as karam, which means generosity. And so on and so on. You find that every single poet comes up with a beautiful definition of futuwa, giving himself. But generally, if you take the good of it, not the first example I've mentioned, futuwa comprises of every single bir, every single good, to the very highest peak. To the very highest peak. Now, and if you want to find an Islamic definition of that, قال أبو علي الدقاق, the Ustad of Abu al-Qasim al-Qushayri, who wrote the Risala al-Qushayriya, he says, and this is somebody who lived when? About 300 years after Hijrah, not too long after the demise of the Tabi'een. Probably in the presence of the Tabi'een, some of them, very old. So he's a Tabi'een. Ayyakuna, his definition is, أَصْلُ الْفُتُوَ أَيَّكُونَ الْعَبْدُ سَاعِيًا أَبْدًا فِي أَمْرِ غَيْرِهِ. The asl of futuwa is that a slave is constantly engaged in serving others, is constantly thinking of the well-being of others. It's almost as if he does not have enough. He's selfless. And Abu Ali al-Daqaq himself says, and the completeness of futuwa has not been attained by anyone except by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. In the dunya and in the akhirah he attained it. Because he says, everybody the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah will look out for his own self, for his own personal security, the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's divine chastisement. And nobody will know what to do. People will run to seek help from Nabi Adam all the way up to Nabi Isa, and everybody will say, Nafsi, 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 myself, myself, please. And they will refer the people on to the prophet that will come afterwards, and so on and so on. And everybody will say, Nafsi, 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 except one, and he won't say Nafsi, but he will say, Ana laha, Ana laha, Ana laha, I'm the one for it. I'm the one for it. I'm the one for it. Like he used to be in the dunya, as it's been narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in the Shama'il as well, it has been narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was never said to say no for everything, for anything that he was asked. No, because he had he has been given possession of all the knowledge, if it was a question based on knowledge, and if it was help, he never ever said no. And we will read inshallah ta'ala in the Shaykh's notes that is beautifully given to us here and beautifully translated by the translator. You will see how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam maintained that character. Now, and this is one of the characters the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam advised the Muslims with when he said his hadith, من نفس المؤمن كربة من كرب دنيا نفس الله عنه كربة من كرب يوم القيامة. Whosoever relieve somebody from a difficulty in this life, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala relieve him from a difficulty in the year after as a prize for what he has done. Can anybody think of a greater difficulty that he can relieve somebody of than the difficulty of kufr, the difficulty of delusion, the difficulty of being caught up in his own little, you know, life, relieving somebody from a sin that is constantly committing? This is the greatest difficulty, because if we look, if we were to see, and I mentioned this in the beginning, if we were to see a scorpion crawling under somebody's blanket and he's about to get ready for bed, then we know it's there and it's very poisonous and it might lead to his death, fatal insect, but it could lead to instant death. If you wanted to tell that person, listen, just watch out before you get in bed, just raise your blankets, and everybody knows already that sunnah also to, you know, shake it all out and before one getting to bed. If he were to do that, the amount of pain he would spare this person, and the amount of difficulty he would alleviate this person from, is tremendous. And if a person were to look, if this particular danger were as dangerous as the hellfire and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's punishment, then the amount of pain and difficulty you're relieving him from is the ultimate pain and difficulty. There's nothing more painful than the burn of in fire forever and forever and forever. Now, so it's something which should sort of pop up in the heads if we see it. But obviously there's adab when a person go about doing these things, when a person go about changing things, there's adab. Sometimes a person need to make taghaful. Not always come up with an answer or maybe with a reprimanding, or maybe with advice immediately. And also there's two things that we need to bear in mind here. There is telling the truth, and there's any advice. And the two is different. There's difference between the two. Now, so relieving somebody from a kurba can be done in different ways. Sometimes you could tell the person, sometimes your character could help the person change and change his course from what he's on to something different. Sometimes it could be not your character but your state, and this sometimes is more effective than anything, and it is the most beautiful way of telling somebody that is wrong, one state. And obviously that doesn't come easily. And this is why we want to hear so more about how to gain that. Now, and what is a kurba? A kurba difficulty is a shiddatun azima. It's a very, very great difficulty. Allati tuqa' sahibu fil kurab. It is somebody. Now, it leads him from one difficulty to another. This is a kurba. Literally, it leads him from one difficulty to another. And Tanfis is to relieve him, not entirely, to remove it entirely, but some of it, because here we have to know the meaning of the word nafasa. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said nafasa, it's not completely relieving from the difficulty entirely, and nobody can relieve somebody from his difficulty entirely unless it's by the means to do so. Not everybody can do is by the means to relieve somebody from a difficulty. So nafasa is a word of ease, that means, you know, because nafasa means to relieve some of the difficulty. So if a person were to show or give advice to somebody, or if the person is involved in some dini work and the intention is da'wah, you know, this is nafasa. This is nafasa. Because you relieve people of some of the difficulties. People see somebody's good character, immediately they're struck. And obviously, this good character has to come with some internal, you know, some internal state. And that internal state is very important. Why is it important? You know, Sayyidina Adi ibn Hatim. Sayyidina Adi ibn Hatim, he came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, "Ya Rasulullah, my father, kana yuqri al-dayf. He used to have guests over to his house. Kana yasil al-rahim. He used to maintain family relations. Kana yahmil al-kal. He used to yalb the needy." He used to yab the poor, and so on and so on. Isn't there a place for him in the Akhirah? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam looked at Adi ibn Hatim. He said, "Your father intended by its status, and that is what he got." You know, good character has to have an intention for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, else, you know, this is important. So I'm just mentioning that there in this particular point here. So there has to be, you know, your father intended by his status and shuhra. This is the word the Prophet used, shuhra, which means fame. وَنَالَهَا وَقَدْ نَالَهَا. And he attained it. He was very famous. And Hatim al-Ta'i is his name. And Adi is a Sahabi. He was the son of Hatim. And subhanAllah, yani, jahili characters, it was filled with futuwa. But the most unfortunate part of it all was there was no intention. And it links up, this particular topic links up with the previous one, which we spoke about, sincerity. And they are very closely linked. So sincerity is like the author said, yani, if I can remember, he said beautiful words in the beginning. It's the golden rule of da'wah. It's the golden rule of da'wah. The da'i can fight and he can do everything, you know. As one of the sahabas asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Ya Rasulullah, a man goes out fi sabilillah and he fights to maintain his dignity. One fights for... because he's shuja', he's brave, and he dies, and the one fights fi sabilillah. Which one is in the Jannah?" The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "The one who fights fi sabilillah." Even though the others attained martyrdom in some sort of way outwardly, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not judge anything about outward acts, but it's the inward thing. So it's a golden rule, it comes back to that. Now, فَمَن نَفَّسَ فَلَهُ النَّفَسِ وَمَنْ فَرَّجَ فَلَهُ الْفَرَجْ فَلَهُ الْفَرَجْ. Whoever relieves somebody, this is the words of Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali. He says, whoever relieves, Allah will relieve him. وَمَنْ نَفَّسَ فَلَهُ النَّفْسِ نَفَسْ وَمَنْ فَرَّجَ. And whoever relieves, نَفَسَ means relieves partly. If you relieve somebody partly of something, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will relieve you the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah of something, not entirely, of all your burdens and worries. وَمَنْ فَرَّجَ. And whoever فَرَّجَ is different from nafas. Because nafas literally means a breath. For somebody to give him a break, you know. so they can breathe again. Sometimes people do such a lot, as got such a lot of burdens, they can't even feel that they're breathing, you know. The burdens suppress them so much. But whoever relieves him from his entire burden, falahul faraj. For him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala relieve him from his entire burden. And in that word lies a great amount of hikmah. Now, so this is the issue we want to, you know, it's the atmosphere we want to swim around in, is the atmosphere of giving generously of oneself. If you go to page 25, this is where the topic starts, inshallah. I'll try to finish the few pages that's written about this particular topic, inshallah ta'ala. And the small book 21, alright, in the small book 21. Now, if you want to make your sideline notes, inshallah ta'ala. So it says, striving to train the nafs to be generous and be willing to spend. This is achieved through spending one's wealth liberally, without hesitation, in the places where it is rewarded and benefit are great. Now, we've previously mentioned when a person gives of oneself to others for the benefit in the dunya and the akhirah, if his giving does not benefit the person in the dunya or in the akhirah, it doesn't mean anything. It has to be beneficial in the dunya and in the akhirah. Now, this is the primary criterion. Now, so when does a person, how does a person know when to give and how to give and where does the benefit lie mostly? Obviously, they say good character starts at home. Good character starts at home. To show one's family, because da'wah is not an overnight process, it's not going to change overnight. A person is not going to make a society da'wah orientated, or maybe a particular area da'wah orientated overnight. It might happen that a person learn outside and become generous and see others showed some examples and character of generosity and picks it up and he feels very highly inclined toward it and he incorporates it in his life and he becomes like that. Can happen. But not everybody goes out and meet the people of generosity, the Ahlul Karam. Not everybody goes out and see how has it been done. People don't really see people spending that much now. Nowadays, yes, in the mosque, if you do go on a Friday, you see a lot of people giving. But then again, also, we don't want to question the intentions behind it. And it's a shame to say that there is a sort of culture that goes on amongst us. That people, if you give somebody some money, then that person is obliged to give that person the same amount of money back. You know, you're not supposed to be obliged if you give money sincerely for that person. If you say, "Well, I've helped that person or that person, I've given on behalf of somebody who died, but he used to be not my family or my father, but he used to be a friend of my father." You know, isali thawab, masalan, yani dashpound or whatever it could be, and then that person's son is obliged by culture to give back das pound if one of his family members die. What is the hikmah in that? And we see a lot of these things going on, but the message doesn't really reach out far further because the nur of the sincerity is not in this particular act. Apart from those who really do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know. We don't want to question, you know. We know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala eventually might just change a person's niyyah because of the dua of those who came afterwards, like Sayyidina Salman al-Farisi used to rebuke the tabi'in. He says, "Don't say these are munafiqin and those are munafiqin. We used to rely on the munafiqin in battle, and when we come back, we never spoke about them. We never mentioned them. That is why the Sahaba Ridwanullah alayhim were of the highest caliber. They thought they were the munafiqin. They never spoke out or made comments, you know. Why? Salman al-Farisi said, Because perhaps the dua of you, the good out of you, might reach this person. When somebody with lots of money comes and builds a nice place for learning, or maybe a mosque, like our elders did, mashallah. But alhamdulillah, we're benefiting from it. There's excellent wudu facilities, nice prayer facilities. People feel so, mashallah, overwhelmed by the design and everything of the mosque internally, outwardly, externally, and internally. And they raise their hands and they say, Subhanallah, Ya Allah, give these people who spend to build this, give them Jannah, or give them this, give them pardon, give them that. It happens, people do raise their hands. So we keep us amongst, you know, quiet on those particular things. But anyway, so spending fi sabilillah, yani the talk diverted away from we went on nifaq and then we went off. Let's come back to the asal that I wanted to speak about is, yani when does our spending benefit? It comes, yani the good character starts at home. So how do we attain good character? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made life easy. Subhanallah, yani subhanallah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a rahmah, was a mercy. He made life easy unto us. If he said very, very, very frequently, his words was very frequently, if you want to spend, if you've got a dinar for a miskin, or if you have a dinar that you want to give to a miskin, or you've got a dinar that you want to spend freeing a slave or part of him, or you've got a dinar to spend fi sabilillah, or you've got a dinar to spend on your Ahlul Bayt, the best dinar spent is on your Ahlul Bayt. Another hadith he says, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were to, إِذَا أَعْطَى اللَّهُ أَحَدُكُمْ خَيْرًا فَلْيَبْدَأْ بِأَهْلِ بَيْتِهِ. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were to bestow upon you good, start at home, start at your Ahlul Bayt. Don't neglect them. Feel, let them see your earnings go on them first before it goes outside. If you're not going to do that, they're going to learn a different message. Islam is not generous. Because, and this is what you want to teach them, Islam is generous. You know, generosity comes, Islam is the peak of generosity. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith related by Mu'adh ibn Jabal, if a person were to ask, now how am I going to start off spending? Obviously, you start off with your, if you're married, start off with your wife and kids. If you're not married, how are you going to start off? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam again said, ibda' bi ummik, thumma bi abik, and then with your father, thumma bi ukhtik, not with your brother because he can do something, but your sister is more vulnerable. Start with your sister, and then with your brother, and then he said, ثم الأدنى فالأدنى, and then the closest and the closest. Who are they? Your cousins and your extended family. Because they will learn that it is because of being a Muslim or because of Islam's teaching generosity that we are living comfortably. My husband would not spend on me, he would spend on other nonsense, dunya things if it wasn't for Islam. But because of Islam, my father is taking care of me. Because of Islam, my husband is taking good care of me. Because of Islam, the mother said, mashallah, my son is looking towards me, and so on. So the surroundings of one's family, they learn a great message from Islam, and that is to be generous, to extend your hand to the closest one to you. And then they learn that generosity is quite beneficial. They learn as they grow up with us. And then they start doing this to others. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَلَا تَنْسَوْا الْجِيرَانِ ذَوِي الْحَاجَةِ. And never forget the jiran, your neighbors. Also again, never said jiran Muslim. Never said jiran Muslim, not your Muslim neighbor. Al-jiran. And we know Islam already is very open in terms of the translation of jiran. It's not specifically Muslim jiran. Anyone. As long as he's a jar, he's a jar. But if he's got a nisbah, if he's got family ties, he's got two haqs. If he's got family ties and he's a Muslim, he's got three huquq, three rights altogether. If he's got only Islam and he's in being a jar, then he's got two rights. And if he's only a jar and not have any family relations, or he is he's not a Muslim, one haq. But that remains a haq. And we've mentioned some qissas regarding the being good to the jar. Now we need to show them how we care about them. And this is part of giving. This is part of giving generously without hesitation. Now, and when also to give in our day and time, you know, the quality of selfishness has grown to a very high level. A person always needs something. And when we ask him, well, can you place your need on the scale and tell me how intensely you need it, is always intense. Right? I needed a satellite navigating system the other day, and it became the most needed thing in my life. And when I got it, it was just another thing. But then another thing came in, that's very most needed. And so it carries on, but we never look and extend our gazes to the other brothers. It might also need something similar to what I need. Or whatever it be, a very small thing. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ told this to his wives. Yani, la tunkiru min al-ma'ruf shay'a. Don't look down at any piece of good you may do. Even if you may lend a needle to somebody, or give a needle as a gift to somebody, it's a ma'ruf, it's khair. That person might just need it at that particular point, and he was just looking for a needle. You fulfilling a need of another person, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will definitely be seen to in terms of your needs the day of your Maqiyama. La tunkir min al ma'ruf shay'a. Don't ever think down upon any, or look down upon any good deed that the person might do. This is a very, very good golden rule. So a person is in the parking lot, for example, and somebody, and you know, you just went in for a couple of minutes to buy something, but you've got a car park ticket of maybe it's another 2 hours. Somebody comes in, you know, well, shall I give it to him, or shall I? That should come to one's mind and says, well, I've got enough time, I will take this. This is a sort of ma'aruf that the person might do. One might move out of a car park, see somebody's looking for a parking area. Says, you know, in that corner over there is a parking. If you go that way, you might find. Something like that. Always be of help and assistance and so on. Always trying to be of help. This simple maybe might sound a bit silly, but the point is, any sort of assistance is great in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Always we heard in the mosque of Damascus, in the subhanAllah, there a person can see really how people give openly. And sometimes we also don't know how people give. People nowadays give through electronic means and so on. The person can't really say whether they are better or we are better, or so make comparisons. But at the doors of the mosque, there was always the people who collected in for the mosque, obviously. But when they had one particular hadith, they always repeated. And the hadith was, or it could have been a hadith, or it could be a saying of the Sahaba, I don't know. One of them were, in anfiq walaw qalila, fa innal qalil indallahi kathir. Spend even though little, and don't be shy, because a little by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a lot. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a hadith, and this hadith is sahih, that a person spends one dirham, which is a silver coin, fi sabilillah, just one, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yaqbaluhu, Allah subhanahu would accept it because of his sincerity, wa yurbihi, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala adds riba on, interest. But this is divine interest, is none like the ones that we're supposed to do in the dunya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can decrease, take and increase, because yani all interest is in his hands. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hatta yurbihi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes this one dirham to increase. The person comes to the day of Yawmul Qiyamah and looks at this mountain of reward, and he gets a shock in the hadith, and Allah subhanahu says, this is your reward for spending so much fi sabilillah, and he does not want to believe it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala affirms him and says, this is the dirham that you spend on such and such a day, and I have kept it for you to increase until it becomes this much. Sometimes we could do something good to somebody, it might just cost a penny, and we might just think, oh, subhanAllah, I'm very cheap, I'm not going to do it, let me just leave it off. But these are all the ma'aruf that is counting in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, so he carries on saying, Sayyidina Shaykh Alawi al-Maliki, he says, now Allah made such great rewards for expenditure as to make the true believer be quick and keen to obtain them. Now, that's the reward we've just spoken about spending. So the person or the believer, if he wants to show off this good character, and he doesn't hesitate, it just comes. And this is also a mark of it. This is a great mark of it to give of oneself. Give of oneself liberally without thinking, if a person may put it that way. It reminds me of the qissa of Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu and Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. It was a time of Tabuk, the Battle of Tabuk, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam needed funds for the jihad. Now, and obviously, we looking and studying contexts of situations, and we can't say our context coincides with theirs. It's a completely different context. And then Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala said to himself, well, this is the opportunity where I'm going to show Abu Bakr that I'm better than him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that I'm better than Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And he said to himself, I'm going to take all my possessions and leave half of it only. Everything apart from the half, I'm going to leave the half with my family, and the other half is going to go to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he did. And he gave it to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala, and the Prophet sallallahu, came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, gave it to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looked at him and said, what have you left for your family? He said, Ya Rasulullah, I've left half of my possessions for them. This is for the ghazwa that you've planned. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala came in, and he came with his possessions. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu said to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, this is for the jihad. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, what have you left for your family? And he said, Ya Rasulullah, I've left him only two things, Allah and his Rasul. And Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looked at Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu while he's saying that. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam accepted it. Well, the qissa goes that Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, after that instant, he wasn't seen. He left it. He gave everything that he has. He wasn't seen for days. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started asking about him. Where is he? Jama'a Salah is not here. So it came out that Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, because he gave everything, between him and his wife, there was one garment shared. And when they were at home, their aura obviously was exposed. But when she wants to pray, she would use the garment, or when he wants to pray salah, he would use the garment to cover his aura. And this word came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent to Sayyida Fatima, said, "Ya Fatima, see what you have for Abu Bakr to cover himself up and let him come to the mosque." And she looked and she found a piece of cloth made of goat hair, which is very rough. And it was sent to Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala. And when he got the piece of hair material, he tried covering himself up and it did not fit. There were still places open of his aura. So what did he do? He covered himself up. The extra bit was with date palm leaves. It was weaved, and he added the extra bit on to cover his knees in such a way. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam expected him at mosque, because he got a piece of material to cover himself up. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to the mosque, he met Sayyidina Jibreel. And Sayyidina Jibreel came in a very, very strange garment. It was exactly the garment Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu dressed up with to make himself ready for salah to come and meet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because the Prophet haven't seen him for a long time. "Why are you dressing up like this, Ya Jibreel?" And Sayyidina Jibreel said, "Ya Rasulullah, I'm dressed to this, like in this manner. And not only me, but all the Malaikatul Kiram, out of the love and respect for what Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu has done, because he's today in this particular garment, in this particular dress." And this shows that the amount that you give, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a way of showing that people are deeply affected when you give yourself. You know, it's the very peak of character. You know, like in this example, there are many other examples, but when a person, I mean, many of us has watched television movies sometimes in the past, you know, and the story or the tale is never complete if there is a hero who does an act of heroism in the movie, when he gives of himself. And this is when the movie reaches its peak. When he gives his own life, sometimes he comes out safe at the end, sometimes he does not. But this is the very peak, you know. The story is not complete until something like this happens. And we see another example of chivalry, of giving oneself. The example of Sayyidina Abu Dharr al-Ghifari. It's the time of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And it's a beautiful book written by Shaykh Abdul Rahman al-Sulami. He mentions these stories, and inshallah ta'ala, if ever can afford the book, it's the book on chivalry by Shaykh Abdul Rahman al-Sulami. These stories and many others are in there to help us grow in chivalryism. In the time of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, three men came into his court. Three men. The two men were brothers, and they brought in somebody who they found, or who gave himself up to these two brothers, somebody who killed their father. And Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu looked at this man and said, "Well, you know, if you killed a nafs, if you take a life, your life should be taken, you know." He said, "I know, Ya Amirul Mu'mineen, I know this. But let me tell you how it happened." He said, "I came to Medina, and on the outskirts of Medina, I took a rest. And while I was having my rest, my horse was starting eating from these dates that grew over this wall. And before I could stop my horse from eating from the dates, an old man stood on top of the wall with a rock. And it was his tree. It was his date tree. And he took the rock and he threw it on the head of the horse, and the horse died instantly. And because my horse was very dear to me, it was, you know, a source of transport and very close and dear to me, I took up a brick or a rock and I threw it back at the man and I killed him instantly. Anger drove me to do this, but I know I have done wrong. I know I've taken a soul, and I'm here to be dealt with according to the Sharia. And Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu told him, well, you are very courageous to say what you're saying. The man said, well, ya Amirul Mu'mineen, indeed, I'm here to give myself up, but I've got a very important amana, he says. And the amana is that I have some money hidden away. Nobody knows where it is, for an orphan. And if you were to kill me, if you were to, you know, give me the punishment of death, then that orphan would not, you know, get the money. And nobody would be able to look after him, or nobody would take care of him properly. So give me 3 days so that I can go and give back this money to this orphan. Only 3 days. So this is in the court of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the Amirul Mu'mineen, and all the Sahaba, the very known ones of them are standing and witnessing this particular trial. And the young man looks around, or rather Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu says to the young man, the only way that you can go and do fulfill this amana is to get somebody to be in your position while you are gone. Somebody that if you wanted to turn up, we would kill him, or the punishment would be upon him. Now who's going to be in this? This man is a complete stranger. So he looks around the court of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he grabs Sayyidina Abu Dharr al-Ghifari, said, this man. Sayyidina Abu Dharr al-Ghifari, he didn't say anything, because subhanAllah, yani, yeah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the man reach out to him and pull him in. And he stood and said, well, I've been chosen. So the man went off, and the first day went, the man didn't show up. Second day went, the man didn't show up. The third day, the man didn't show up. And everybody's waiting now, because sunset, Maghrib time would be the end, beginning of a new day. And it's close to sunset, and everybody's awaiting the man's arrival. And nobody can see any dust coming in the horizon. And Sayyidina Abu Dharr al-Ghifari is standing awaiting to take the punishment of somebody that he doesn't even know. SubhanAllah. Yani, the mark of chivalry is of such that you give your whole life for somebody, sometimes, even though you don't know what you're doing, but you're just doing the right thing. And Sayyidina Abu Dharr al-Ghifari waits and waits, and it's before sunset, and they saw the man coming in a very hasty manner, out of breath, dusty. And he said, Ya Amirul Mu'mineen. He came in the court. And everybody, obviously, at that time, very tense, atmosphere. This is a very noble Sahabi, Abu Dharr al-Ghifari. Are we going to lose him because of somebody that he doesn't even know? Or we don't even know him? And the man came into the court and he said, Ya Amirul Mu'mineen, I've told you, I'm a man that has nothing in my heart except the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I'm here to take my punishment. I've done my amana, completed it, I've given the money to the orphan, and I'm here to fulfill another amana, which is to give my life in return for the life that I've taken. And the two brothers are there that particular day to wait for this person to come back, and they've seen him and they were there to witness him, his comeback, his return. And at that moment, they were so overwhelmed by the mark of chivalry of this particular person, that even though he could have run away, he could have stayed away, he could have, you know, but the amount of fear that he had for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the amount of, trust in amana and siddiq that he had, brought him back. And this was enough a sign for the brother to say, if there is no more rahmah left, if we were not to forgiven this man, we would hear the people say that there is no more rahmah left amongst the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We forgive you. And so they forgive the person. And this is what can happen shara'an. If the offspring forgive the person, then he is forgiven. So Sayyidina Abu Dharr al-Ghifari was asked afterwards by the people, "Ya Abu Dharr, did you know this person?" He said, "Wallahi, I swear by Allah, I don't know this person from anywhere." And this is also a mark of chivalry, because he saw the siddiq in this person, he stood. This person's true intention. And this is all signs of chivalry, and it brings out the best in the person, something which obviously we know the chivalry and things attached to it, character attached to it, like karam, which means your generosity, like a najda, which means to always be there to safeguard others, to spend on others, and to relieve others of burdens, and these type of things called najda. These are all marks of the Arabs before Islam and so on. And this is something which has to be found in a da'i when he gives da'wah, now. One such reward is that he increases his blessings upon the persons, and spending is essentially an expression of gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Indeed, if somebody spends on somebody else, no matter how much it may be, it may be money, it may be effort, it may be time one spends with somebody else, just sitting and comforting, whatever it may be, all of this is signs of generously spending of one's own possessions. And when a person does it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives increase. If it's time that you spend, Allah gives increase in barakah in your time. This is why we find some of the awliya, they used to pray alfu raka'a for tahajjud, 1,000 raka'at for tahajjud. How did they get the time? Some of the awliya, Imam al-Nawawi mentions in the adhkar, they used to make 30 khatma fil yawm, 30 completions of the Quran in one day. How did they get that right? Baraka in time. Okay, that is all the ones who did the greatest amount, but there were others who did a khatma every day. How did they get the time? Some of them did three khatams every day. Some of them did a khatam every week. Some of them did, different amounts, but if you look at it, incredible in comparison to what we have, if we were to look at it, we should be ashamed to ask, where is our time? How do we spend our time? When a person spends on others, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives barakah in the time. Sometimes a particular thing might be difficult on one, and we're struggling to get it done, and we're struggling, but sometimes the struggle could have been relieved if we would have stepped out of our own selfishness and attained to other people's needs at that moment, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would have unfolded the whole matter with ease and made it easy for us. See, many a times it happens when a person does something like that. But many a times it happens. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives increase. Somebody with money, where people give money, fi sabilillah, the only thing that will happen is increase. Like Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Sayyidina Uthman, the day of Ghazwatul Tabuk, he gave so many horses with saddles and armor and spend on so many men that were going to enter into this battle. Spend on them for food and clothes and armor. So many hundreds of them. And somebody asked him, Ya Uthman, what's going on? Where's your money? Where's your money going? It's all being spent. He says, how do you mean it's all being spent? How do you mean it's all being spent? I'm spending on somebody whose pockets are deep, in the way he mentioned it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees this act, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward. Don't you read the ayah in the Quran? وَإِنْ تَأَذَّنَ رَبُّكَ وَإِنْ تَأَذَّنَ رَبُّكَ لَإِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wishes, if you show gratitude, Allah subhanahu إِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. If you show gratitude, then I will increase you. And showing gratitude, there's many ways of showing gratitude. If Allah gives you ni'mah, like money, health, time and everything, and you give of it generously, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase you. This is why the ulama used to say, shukr is qaydul mawjood wa saydul mafqood. Qaydul mawjood means you're tying up that which you have in the moment, which means maybe the money that you already have. In order for this money to remain that I have, mashallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave me a lot of wealth this year. What am I going to do with it? Buy this and buy that for myself. No. First thing that comes to mind is give out X amount, sadaqah, maybe for madrasa, give out maybe for a particular organization, give out on your family first of all, the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prefers us to spend, and then to the family and so on and so on. This is tying the rest of the money with one. And it is saydul mafqood. Were the next year to come, then that would be another prosperous, you know, full of prosperity. And a great alim, Ibn Atayla Sakandari, says in a beautiful aphorism, he says, مَنْ لَمْ يَشْكُرِ النِّعْمَةِ فَقَدْ تَعَرَّضَ لِزَوَالِهَا. Who does not show gratitude for the ni'am Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him, فَقَدْ تَعَرَّضَ لِزَوَالِهَا. He made himself prone to losing that ni'mah. وَمَنْ شَكَرَهَا. And whosoever thanks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the ni'mah Allah has given them, فَقَدْ قَيَّدَهَا بِعِقَالِهَا. He is tied with the iqal. With the iqal, which is the hobbling cord the Arabs used to wear in the head. When they stop with the camel are tied up immediately so it doesn't run away. So you have made a hobbling cord over your money and your wealth and your time and your health, whatever you own, if you spend with it. The car, for example, the car is driven to show off, mashallah, beautiful car. When the alim or when the ustad or when the lecturer comes from overseas to give a lecture, the car is parked away, not of service. Right? This is the time we should spend. You know, I would be the first car to drive Sidi Fulan, mashallah, from the airport. This type of attitude and mentality should be in our minds, in our character. If it be somebody coming on from a far place, we should open our tables if we can, if we are able to do so. And these are all things that increase one in barakah. Now, I've not seen somebody expend on other people except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him an increase. And it's constant increase. Now, and this was the character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, if you show gratitude, I will certainly grant you increase. Certainly. Another is that he entrusted an angel. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala entrusted an angel to supplicate for the one spending in charity, that whatever he spends be replaced. So a person spends maybe a great sum of money, will be replaced. And if it will not be replaced, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give many a times more in amount than what one is spent in the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah, the time when one will wish that no reward has been given to one in the dunya. Because this dunya is so short, one, you just don't realize it. إِنَّهُمْ يَرَوْنَهُ بَعِيدًا وَنَرَاهُ قَرِيبًا. Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّهُمْ يَرَوْنَهُ بَعِيدًا. And in the kuffar, in the people that's involved in this dunya, they see it as very far, the akhirah. وَنَرَاهُ, and we see it as very close. وَنَرَاهُ قَرِيبًا. You see it as very close. And this is the mentality of a mu'min. When he spends now, he knows that is what he has with him. It's like Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when the sheep was slaughtered. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam bring the meat to me. The meat was brought to him. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was giving out the meat to this one and to that one and to this one, and then there was only the shank left, which is a part of a hoof. There's almost no meat on it. And say the Aisha to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "Ya Rasulallah, look what we are left with. We've got only the shank. You know, you've given all the meat away." The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "No, Ya Aisha, we have everything apart from the shank. This needs to go so that we can have it." This needs to go as well so that we can have it. So when you give out, you are actually securing your life over there. It's like people, you know, there's not a new thing, you know, everybody is trying to get a holiday house somewhere in Egypt, somewhere in Morocco, wherever. Now it's all around the world, Spain, and they're coming around here now. It's, you know, everybody's trying to buy houses abroad and securing. And, you know, take that scenario, but just change it around. We are securing our house in the Jannah, our house in the Jannah, and making it beautiful, spending on it, trying to get ready, you know, for us and our family. The day of Raha, of rest, is going to come. Their day of Raha is in the dunya. Every summer, they just switch off completely, switch off from work. No troubles, no nothing. Go for, you know, 100% enjoyment. And there you go. And then they go to the holiday houses, beautiful scenery, nice crystal clear waters, and dive in the pools and all of these lovely niceness. This is what they get. This is what they get. And it will stop there for them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blows the whistle, says, "Stop now, everything. Stop." And it's the time when we will enjoy our raha. Our raha. So it is struggle and struggle and struggle and struggle and struggle. Yani in the dunya, jannatul mu'min was sijnu, jannatul kafir was sijnul mu'min. Jannatul kafir was sijnul mu'min. And this is something, hadith sahih, but it's so commonly read, jannatul mu'min again. I mean, jannatul kafir again, you know, okay. But that is a great hikmah as a hadith that needs to be with us constantly, you know. Whenever we see things in enjoyment of the kuffar, and enjoyment that they go through, subhanallah. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives it to us without us, you know, being tamir over it, you know, lusting over it and trying to gain it, and every hour is you know, seeing that we try to spend it in the feasibility dunya every hour. Now this is not how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to be, you know. Because those hours, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the most disappointment or the greatest disappointment upon a mu'min the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah is an hour that was not spent fi sabilillah. In other words, not spent lillah, not fi sabilillah. The word fi sabilillah sometimes brings up the question of jihad. No. Every single step a person does can be lillah and fi sabilillah. Not only that, every single breath can be lillah and fi sabilillah. It depends on how much we have the concept of ma'iyatul rabb with us, ma'iyatullah, you know, being with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are, or ma'iyatul rasul, or, you know, closest with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wherever we are. Now, very important point I was going to make, but it sort of drove me off. Anyway, so back to generosity. Generosity is important, and it's showing our generosity brings increase. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears in the Quran that it will bring us increase. Now, and the angels, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent an angel to replace that increase. And Imam al-Bukhari and Imam Muslim radiallahu ta'ala anhuma narrated in the hadith, which is a hadith regarding this particular point. They said, as in Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, who said that the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, "Not a day passes and people awake the mornings, except the two angels descend. One of them says, 'O Allah, give the one who spends in charity replacement for what he spends.' The other says, 'O Allah, destroy the wealth of the misery of the miserly person. I haven't spent in ages. Question comes to you maybe sometimes. I'm a talib ilm, I'm a student. I'm spending on my studies. But your very spending on your studies with the intention could make it your spending fi sabilillah. Oh well, I'm spending this to benefit the Muslims. Khairan, there you're spending on the Muslims. Also, if a person does not have the money after you can't spend it, you don't have anything to spend at all. The Sahaba radhiyallahu anhu came once to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with the same query. And he said, Ya Rasulullah, dhahab ahlu dhuthuri bil ujur. The people of wealth, they took all the ujur, all the ajr. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam looked at him and said, أَوَلَيْسَ قَدْ جَعْلَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ مَا تَصَدَّقُونَ. Even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala given you also means to give sadaqah. They look at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How, Ya Rasulullah? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to them, أَلَيْسَ بِكُلِّ تَكْبِيرَةٍ صَدَقَةٍ. Isn't it with every takbirah that you are doing is a sadaqah? وَبِكُلِّ تَحْمِيدَةٍ صَدَقَةٍ. With every tahmida saying, Alhamdulillah, sadaqa, wa kulli tasbihatin sadaqa, wa bi kulli tahlilatin sadaqa, and so on and so on. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them, with everything that you do is a sadaqa. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them, even wa fi budhi ahadikum sadaqa, even in the loins of one of you, there's even sadaqa in there. And they said, Subhanallah, Ya Rasulullah, how can you speak like that, Ya Rasulullah? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, na'am, like a person uses his private parts in haram and he will get a wizard, a punishment for it. Likewise, if he uses it fi halal, he will get a reward for it, and that will be a sadaqah. And that will be a sadaqah. And to sum it up, you know, that the tahleel and the dhikr and so on is one of the most strangest things that I personally have come about dhikrullah, because it's a powerful means to change the inner part, the inner self, to rise higher. It's amazing what it can do. Quran, reading Quran, for example, sometimes people can be in a complete different world if they read the Quran with understanding and they concentrate. It's one of the things that relieve you of all your troubles. And likewise, somebody came with to Sayyidina Hassan al-Basri. Somebody complains, Ya Imamuna, it doesn't rain. He said, Astaghfirullah. Another person came and he said, I've got so many troubles and I'm sad. He said, Astaghfirullah, just make istighfar. Another man came in and he said, there's so many ma'asi. He said, just make istighfar. Another man came and said, I'm poor, I don't have anything. He said, Astaghfirullah. You know, seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Say, Astaghfirullah. And so the people said afterwards, Ya Hassan al-Basri, what was his name? Abul Qasim. What kind of fatwas are you giving to these people? Somebody comes in, it doesn't rain, he said, make istighfar. Somebody came complaining about faqr, about poverty, he said, make istighfar. Somebody came and explained his inner, you know, sorrowness and so on, and they said, depression and stuff, whatever it may be, he said, make istighfar. Somebody came and said, well, there's lots of ma'asi around, he said, make istighfar. He said, yeah, I said istighfar because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran has given istighfar the answer for all of these problems, and he gave me the ayat from the Quran. Now, he gave him the ayat from the Quran. They're all in the Quran. The one that I can remember. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammad. فَقُلْتُ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفَّارًا يُرْسِلِ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدْرَارًا وَيُمْدِدَكُمْ بِأَمْوَالٍ وَبَنِينَ وَجَعَلْ لَكُمْ جَنَّاتٍ وَجَعَلْ لَكُمْ أَنْهَارًا. Sayyidina Nuh said to the, in the Surah Nuh, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, فَقُلْتُ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ. So I told my people, make istighfar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يُرْسِلِ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدَرَارًا. The sama will open up for you, is rain. وَيُمْدِدَكُمْ بِأَمْوَالٍ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will increase you in money. وَبَنِينَ. And children. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make your gardens and your plantations grow. and is prosperous. Just make istighfar. Make istighfar. It's a dhikr. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, Istaghfirullah fa inni la astaghfirullah fi al-yawm mi'ata marra. Hadith sahih. Make istighfar because I make istighfar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala 100 times every day. Every day, every day. It relieves you from a lot of trouble. And this is one of the things that, you know, the power of dhikrullah. Naam. Another of Allah's rewards is protection from calamity. Proved by the hadith which Ruzayn narrates on the authority of Ali ibn Abi Talib, who said, the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa said, hasten to give charity because it prevents the tribulations from descending. Now, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in another hadith, Inna as-sadaqata tutfi'u ghadab al-Rabb. It's a famous hadith. Mu'ad ibn Jabal related this particular hadith. Give sadaqah because it cools the boiling wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, it cools. And where there's no sadaqah in a country, people are miserly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can punish them in two ways. Either Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends them a punishment physically, let them lose all the wealth, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did it with previous nations and lost their wealth, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could leave them for istidraj, them thinking that they are okay, so they continue with the miserliness until they are so steeped into it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just surprises them. Because if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends a subtle punishment here and there over the country because of miserliness, then that's a rahmah actually. You know? It's like in Damascus, when we entered into Damascus in 1995, by the time we came to 2001, things looked different in Damascus. So all the satellite, infiltrating into the minds and the hearts of the young through the television and these type of things. It affected them. You could see changes in the character of the Shamis, apart from those who are very religious, who kept on the path, who don't have television and these. The ulama, they start speaking on the manabir. We have to increase in our sadaqah. And we have to do this, increase in this. Or they were trying to follow the means to alleviate and to remove this chastises difficulty that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent upon the nation. Because what happened? There was no rain. There was absolutely no rain. Normally, Damascus used to have water pipelines running to Jordan and to other nearby countries. One of them was Lebanon, because they had lots of springs. And underneath Damascus is one of the hikam where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Subhanahu alladhi asra bi'abdihi layla min al-masjid al-harami ila masjid alladhi barakna hawla. Around the masjid al-aqsa, there's all that land is full of barakah. Certain parts of the lands, of that barakah land, did not have much water. And the source for Sham, for water, is what is known as Sham today. Underwater springs is in Damascus, so they had water led by pipes to Jordan, and they had to stop that because Sham didn't have water for itself almost because of the Ma'asi. And then they started giving sadaqah, they started giving praying Salatul Istisqa. And one of the particular days when they prayed Salatul Istisqa, I was a witness to it. The following week, it rained whole week. SubhanAllah. It's amazing, subhanAllah. Just when we show that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we can't anymore. And Sheikh Muhammad Saeed Ramadan al-Bouti gave a long speech. And obviously, you humiliate yourself. You show you are abd to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We can't do anymore. And the reason why the ulama was speaking about make salat mishka, make salat istisqa to the people, we need to make salat mishka, come everybody together. But obviously this can't happen until the government agrees. The government was very, very, you know, controlling, you know, anything that happens against its wishes and walls. We don't want to repeat another massacre or whatever. So it was actually so intense, you know, that the Hafiz al-Assad rang Sheikh Muhammad Said Ramadan Abuti up, because he mentioned this. Rang him up in the evening and tell him, we need to do Salatul Istisqa. Even Amir and President of Syria knew that there was no other way out. And what they actually did was, the clouds were impregnated with water. And it was just, you know, the obvious thing, when clouds are so heavy, it should fall, but nothing fell. And it happened when the whole Damascus is dark because of all the clouds, but no rain, absolutely no rain. It will fall a little bit, and it will dry up immediately. So what they did was, they had explosions sent up and explode the clouds to let the water fall. And Sheikh Ramadan Abudi said to the Ra'is, he said to him, you can do whatever you want. This was before he decided to call him up to make Salat al-Istisqa. You can do whatever you want. Look out there at our people. Look at what they are. Look at their closeness to the religion. Look at them, how far they were from the religion. And he said, well, there's probably no other answer. But he did not give decision to make Salat al-Istisqa and the go-ahead until he rang him up. So there was this big, mashallah, Salat al-Istisqa in Jami' al-Umawi. And it rained for a whole week after that. Amazingly. Subhanallah. The point is, subhanallah, yani, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees us not doing our job as Muslim, the water stops. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us difficulty. But when we give sadaqah, and when we do as Allah subhanahu wants us to do, everything will go easy. Now, so yeah, hasten to give charity because it prevents tribulations from descending. Now, furthermore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses the giver of charity with good health and heals him from sicknesses, as it has been narrated in the hadith. Protect your wealth by paying zakat and treat the sick with charity. There's many beautiful instances like this in the life of an example of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And these examples of beauty, Shaykh Muhammad Alawi al-Maliki chose beautiful ahadith, yani ahadith that we really ponder about a lot. The one, like for example, Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu ta'ala anhu said that the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never said no. When he was asked for anything, Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who was the servant of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in his house narrates that a man once asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for charity, and he gave him all the sheep between two mountains. Subhanallah. The man then returned to his people. He said, become Muslim, because truly Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gives without fear of poverty. This is the hikmah, you know, when the people who are not Muslim, and they see this character, automatically it pulls them and draws them closer to this particular religion. Where do you get this from? We get it from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is where you get it from. No. He gave more than one person 100 camels, and he gave Safwan radiallahu ta'ala anhu 100, then 100, then another 100. This was how he was before he was given prophethood. Before Rasulullah was given prophethood, this is how he was. He returned to the tribe of Hawazin. Their captives was numbered 6,000. He gave Al-Abbas so much gold that he was unable to carry it. Sayyidina Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu came to him after one of the battles. And Sayyidina Abbas said, Ya Rasulullah, what's my share? He said, sit down. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was putting gold. He said, sit down and open your they call it lungi or your izar, open it up. And so he was stretching his izar out like this, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam folded up, and he didn't say anything, and it became more and more and more, and the Prophet said, "Now stand up," and he couldn't stand up. That's your share. Once 90,000 dirhams were brought to him and placed on a mat, he rose and distributed it, and did not turn away a single person until there was nothing left. Nothing left of it. Then a man once came to him to ask him for a share. So we said to him, "I have nothing now, but by what you need, by what you need on my account, and I have some money, and I will pay it back to that person." And Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, "Allah did not burden you with more than more you are able to do." And the Prophet sallallahu didn't like that, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he looks deeper into things, you know. When he gives now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees this. If he doesn't reward me and give me a return, any refund, complete refund, or maybe with an increase, then it's going to be in the year after. And this is where I want it to be. So I'm not afraid. So here it goes. I want it to be in the year after, not in the dunya. But if it comes, alhamdulillah, we'll not be that happy, but alhamdulillah, because we want it to be there for us. Alhamdulillah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't like that command. And then a man from the Ansar, he said, "Oh Messenger of Allah, spend in charity and do not fear from the master of the throne a decrease in wealth." On hearing this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam smiled, and the pleasure could be seen in his face. "This is what I have been ordered," he said. "This is what I have been ordered to do," he said. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to be more perturbed when he had money than when he did not have money. He was more relaxed. And this is actually some men always sort of within the company says, "Well, mashallah, managed to save up so much and so on. I'm going to buy this and I'm going to buy that and so on." The other poor guy will say, "Whenever I put money, it just goes. The only person that can save is my wife, and she's not the one that works. So I always poor." So it's not actually by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The one who spends, if he spends on others, especially his family, this is a successful person. Once the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was praying Asr, and normally after the Salah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sits. It was the adab of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to sit and make dhikrullah for a long time, and then he would go and depart. It was Asr. He just made "Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah," and greeting the people, "Assalamu alaykum," the angels and the jinn on his left and right. Stood up immediately and ran into his house. Sahaba was completely astonished. What's going on? Where's the dhikrullah afterwards? And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came back and he said, "I've just remembered I had some gold which I placed aside and I forgot about it. And while I was praying, I remembered, and I immediately went and took it and gave it to Fisabilillah." And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was like that outside Ramadan. In Ramadan, he was even more generous. In the way it was explained, "Karrih al-mursala." You know, when he used to give something, "Rih al-mursala" is a very soft and fast wind. To do generous things and to give of his time, effort, and money, he was even more hasty and move up and down quickly. He was like, you know, what can I do next? Fast and quick. You know, whatever he has, money comes and goes, comes and goes, and so on. So this is the type that we need to show out there for this world, what this Prophet was like, and what does Islam teaches us. If you have money, whatever, you know. It's strange, we hardly see this, but have you ever seen people fighting to pay the petrol bill? You hardly see this here in this country. If somebody goes, gives, you know, two guys, well, the owner of the car, he gets out, and then he pays his petrol bill, he comes back. The guy next to him, his friend or whatever, brother, whatever, he's like, this is how it should be. It's his car, it's not mine. I shouldn't pay it. But when a person goes to the heartlands, Muslim heartlands, and you see how Muslims operate amongst one another, we'll have a different concept of relieving one another from burdens or just, you know, paying something. I once drove a taxi in Damascus, and it's a friend of mine, like, mashallah, it's you. He was a taxi driver, Syrian Kurdi, and we were very close with him. I got in the taxi, and he was driving, so I gave him my 10 Syrian lira for the trip. He said, no, I don't want it. I said, come on, here's it, take it. I want to show, well, you have to take it, so much generosity. So I put it on the chair. He stopped the taxi in the middle of the road, screeching tires. He jumped out so fiercely and angrily, and he flinged open the sliding door, and he said, get out. I took my money and put it back in my pocket, and he smiled, and he came back in the car, and he drove home. This is the type that we don't see. People, if they will see you, if you come to the restaurant, it's always an argument. It's always an argument. And I was told by, you know, amongst Muslims, it should be like that. Not an argument, but inshallah, there should be a nice settlement at the end of the day. Okay, I buy now, you can buy next week, fine. Next week comes, you buy again. And so on. The people will pick up this character and say, well, subhanAllah, when I go home, I'll do this again to other people. They will learn this. They might not do it to you because they know with you it's a losing battle. But they will do it to others. And one of the our friends here is a revert, English revert from London. Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made his Islam beautiful. He went to study and he became a alim. And he told me, he said, you know, when we used to get friends over to our house, we used to play as children, and we used to come to lunchtime, we used to say, it's time to go home now, eh? Now, Muslims, when we have children over, you don't go home until you eat. Or you ring up, says, it's okay if you can eat here at our house, and so on. This is what we do. This is what we do. This is a Muslim character, this Islamic character. If we maintain this, and we share it, we take it across board, not only amongst ourselves, but over. When we bring in the culture of, where the child comes and says, mother or ummi, I don't know these plates. Whose plates are this? No, this is aunt and auntie fulan and auntie fulana's plates and so on. So you get, on your shelf, there's other plates, right? Of other people, because you gave them and they gave back. This is always should be in a Muslim kitchen. In Christian kitchens, or let's say generalized non-Muslim kitchens, what do we find there? Only their cutlery. And this is something which is something we need to share and keep up. And but we have to take it across board. Send it out to other people. You know, generous with our money, with our time, and with everything that we possess. Now, time might be past 7 o'clock now. So I think there's a lot more that can be said about that, but about generosity. It's the very peak of futuwa when people give of themselves. You know, the character comes very deep. It's an Arab culture, but the Arabs had refined it, and the da'wah spread all over the world, and it reached everybody. Wherever there's Muslims now, they maintain this particular character and so on. So alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen for Islam that came to teach us generosity. I just want to end off with one particular few things of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who had this character of giving. And giving doesn't come in only, you know, like we said, money. Just a few ahadith on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, since he is the perfect example. And to see closely, you know, in detail, how he attained this particular, this adab, you know, generosity. In And Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu described the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the hadith, it's in the Shamail al-Tirmidhi. He said, Kana Jalilul Mashas wal Katadi. Kana Jalilul Mashas wal Katadi. Yani, he used to be Awdimul Ru'us al Mafasil. His bone structure, it was thick and it was, especially on the Mafasil where the joints are, it was strong. وَخَاصَةً مَا بَيْنَ الْكَتِفَيْنِ, especially between the shoulders, strong. And I was told by Sidi about if you do physical acts. Sidi Zafrani mentioned this. If you do physical acts, your bones increase and it becomes strong. Your bones, if you do a lot of physical, then your bones become strong. And we can't think that the Prophet ﷺ did only physical acts to benefit himself before Nubuwwah and after Nubuwwah. This is how the Prophet ﷺ used to be. He has to be physically strong. That's more. شَشْنُ الْكَثَّيْنِ وَالْقَدَمَيْنِ. Shash means he used to have rough hands. Even though some other Sahabas describe the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ma masastu yani dibajan alyan min kaffi rasulillahi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I have not touched a salt more softer than the hands of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And sometimes your hands can become soft, sometimes it can become rough, depending on the situation. But the Prophet didn't always have soft hands, gentle hands. The way Sayyidina Ali, a close relative, companion, described the hands of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was rough, because he used to be there for his ummah, for his family, for his people, and his feet of walking, the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam walked, in the manner that he walked in, and the service that he gave to the people, it all can be seen in his feet, the way he walked. It's not gently looked after feet, none. And so on and so on. He described the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's physique, and then he described his character. أجود الناس كفا, most generous in giving. وأجرى الناس صدرا, the most أجرى means brave, doesn't fear anything, and his heart is filled with yaqeen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's, you know, an explosion. The sound of an explosion is something which was unheard of in the time of the Prophet ﷺ. Something like that, like a massive bang. And there was a sound like that in the time of the Prophet ﷺ. And it was evening, or almost time for dawn. And nobody left their houses. Is this Qiyamah or what? Everybody was shocked. Even the most bravest of the Sahaba didn't leave, because if this is Qiyamah, what am I? And when the sun came out and everybody pulled up courage to really now make a move, because it was after that sound, it was silent for a long time. They finally pulled up courage and they went out in the direction where the sound came from. And they saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam coming with his horse. From the sound, and he went to go check out what it was. And he came with full armor gear, immediately dressed up, hanged the sword over his neck, because this is where they used to hang the sword. Used to be like where they put the revolver in nowadays. This is where the sword used to be in. And his horse, and he came back and he said, at ease, everybody, it's yani, whatever it was. Asdaqun nasi lahjatan, the most honest when he speaks. وَأَوْفَ النَّاسِ ذِمَّةً, he was the أوفى, he used to fulfill his promise, never broke his promise. أَلْيَنُهُمْ عَرِيكَةً, he used to have a very gentleness, good gentleness with him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught him the best character. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَدَّبَنِي رَبِّي فَأَحْسَنَ تَأْدِيبِي, an example of the ta'adib that Allah gave to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said when the, you know, he said in the Quran, وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْ فَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ فَعْفُ عَنْهُمْ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ وَشَاوِرْهُمْ فِي الْأَمْرِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, if you were to be fadh, harsh, fadh, crush with your tongue, غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ, hard-hearted, you know, لَنْ فَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ, they wouldn't have gathered around you. So this was the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And most of his spending was against kufr and fusuq. Yani kufr and fusuq, those days we talk about injustice being done to people. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam lived with a great amount of injustice being practiced around him as he grew up. And Sayyida Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anhu, She also reminds us of one of the good character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when she said, when he came down from the mountain of Jabal Nur, Mount Nur, and he came, he said, he told her about the first revelation, and she said to him, I believe that you might be this Nabi that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen for us. And he said, why? And Sayyida Khadija said, because you give to the poor, you maintain family relationships, you see to the needy. And she gave a lot of good characters. And all of these good characters also giving. You always speak the truth. And speaking the truth means not, well, mashallah, it's also a character of giving, because sometimes a person can lie and get away with it. But you give, you put yourself into a complete difficult situation and you say, well, I did it. The author of the Dalalul Khairat, Imam al-Jazuli, there was a great battle between two sort of not madhabs, but they were Muslims, but there was tribal feuds between them, and there was a murder, and it was going to end up into complete bloodshed, you know, battle between these two, and they wanted to know who killed this, and who said, who killed this person? Imam al-Jazuli, he stand up, he said, I killed him. And so he had to flee with his own life. This is why he was buried in a completely different place, and then his body was brought back. It's one of the karamat, his body never decayed. And the people who brought him back was obviously one of his muridin, who brought him back to Maghrib, and he was used as a shield in war at all times. Whenever they used to go in battle, his body used to be in a coffin, and he was taken into the battle as for barakah. So yani on that point, and Imam al-Jazuli gave up his life. He said, I killed him. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the shuhra, the fame of him, raise up, and everybody benefited from his chivalry and his futuwa, his character that he had. And partly of that character is because of the close relationship he had with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's much more that we can speak about this for hours. But alhamdulillah, what we said, inshallah, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us practice, to grant us implementation, and to grant us closeness with the lifestyle of the perfect example. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Al-Fatiha. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salam ala ashraf al-Muslim, Sayyidina wa Nabiyyina wa Mawlana Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. يا ربنا لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك ولعظيم سلطانك سبحانك لا نحصي ثناء عليك أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وذنوب والدينا ومشائخنا ولجميع المسلمين أجمعين ربنا يسر ولا تعسر ربنا تمم بالخير وأنت يا الله الكريم يسر اللهم وفعنا ما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا الحمد لله على كل حال ونعوذ بالله من حال أهل الضلال برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين الحمد لله. The rest of the part of generosity should be read, inshallah ta'ala. There's plenty more very, very, very useful ahadith for ourselves in the inshallah. Alhamdulillah.
Actually, we just want to remind you all as well. The Sheikh was talking about giving, and the Islamic Society is organizing a charity week, which is going to be from Monday the 26th of November till Friday the 30th, not next week, the week after. We're going to have a meeting tomorrow about trying to organize some activities and what we want to do. So, if you can please try and come to that and get involved in trying to raise money in however you can. We're trying to raise money for orphans in third world countries in conjunction with Islamic Relief. So the meeting tomorrow, inshallah, is at 5 o'clock in the Parkinson building. It's room 108, so if you walk past the cafe upstairs, then it's on the left hand side. So if you can all try and try and come.
Inshallah. Inna al-qaleela inda Allahi kathir. Really, a little bit, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a lot. I've seen the poster, inshallah ta'ala. Good luck. Inshallah ta'ala. This is another poster that says, time for change. And time for change as well, because you get the change. time for change, to spend the change. So, inshallah ta'ala.
Can I ask one question?
Oh, pardon.
I found some new practice in the mosque around Leeds now, which I don't found it before, that during the Jum'ah prayer, after the bayan, there is announcement about the person who spent money to the mosque for £100 by this person, and then £150 for the from this person, and he asked us to make a dua. Do you think it is a good practice? I'm not going to say they are wrong. Maybe they have their own reason. Do you think it should be continued, or we should stop the practice?
First of all, we won't be able to stop it. But I always try to find a makhraj for the people. If I can't stop it, I try to find a makhraj. A makhraj is to give them the benefit of the doubt. I've not seen this practice anywhere else apart from here, and I'm sure it's in Pakistan. Because the people who do it, they're from Pakistan. But the makhraj that I found for them is, Allah says in the Quran, فَلِذَلِكَ فَلْيَتَنَافَسِ الْمُتَنَافِسُونَ. And for that reason, let those who want to compete. The intention is not left up to me, it is left up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sahabas before gave out generously, publicly, in front of everybody, great numbers, small numbers, but they had good intentions. If people give out, or if they mention the names for the sake of tanafus in khair, something good, if they intend that, but if it is back to the cultural thing that I've mentioned before, that I have to scratch his back because he scratched my back, and then it's not going to be for their benefit in the year after, but to their detriment, because they're not going to see the thawab of that. Now, so my own answer to that is, I'll give a makhraj to these people, and the makhraj is they are competing in khair. But trying to stop it, I don't think it's going to be an easy task, to be honest. People have, as part of the culture, as part of the ways, unless we set up our own mosque and we don't do it, Wallahu alam. But I know where you're coming from, back where I come from, where we don't hear this. People give generously silently. There's a box or there's somebody that come around. Some mosques hear also from people from the background do it differently. But this is something new to me as well. Like it is to some other people as well. But I think the makhraj, I think, should be used. Because we don't know the need of the people. People might just give it, inshallah ta'ala, lillah. If it's mentioned, you know, it's just became so cultural that people don't even intend to boast You know, just keep it in a modest manner even sometimes. And at the end of the day, look what all of that money build up in this country, because we really look at it. If you look at the situation of the people when they came here, their futu was age, and their fatah age, very young. If a person is a fatah, he's in between 15 years old and 30 years old. After 30 years old, he becomes a kahl. Kahl means he's declining slowly, like myself and some other people. And if he becomes 40, between 40 and upwards, he is a sheikh. Sheikh means somebody that's not really, he's got lots of wisdom in his, you know. But the fatah age, this is when these people came over, very vibrant and excited, you know. And they became affected by the lifestyle, yeah. Many of them ended up drinking, many of them ended up doing wrong things and so on. But there was this need for a mosque. People didn't even know when it was Jumu'ah, when it was Eid, when it was Ramadan. They had this confusion then. So there was this need for mosque. And the way these mosques are all standing today, mashallah, and pure delight and beauty, is because of this tanafus that went on in the mosque. You know, this competition that went in the mosque. Some nights we hear, it's a bit agitating, I must say, because on Eid, you know, the best thing a person can do is takbiratul ihram. When you go to the mosque, you expect the takbiratul, to hear the takbiratul ihram. The takbir, not the takbiratul ihram, but the takbir. You know, Allahu Akbar, maybe melodiously. But you hear nothing but, you know, pounds and pounds and pounds, dust pound and this pound, and, you know. So it becomes a little bit agitated. You become a little bit agitated. And I think sometimes it could be, mosque committees need to sort of give time to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as well. And then if we do, inshallah, ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give us barakah in whatever we earn, get in. But that's my makhraj, wallahu ta'ala alam. Well, yeah. Any other questions? Yeah, inshallah.
Can you